How's everyone doing? All right, good. Why don't we get started? Very happy to be here this evening. I'm Damon Connolly, your county supervisor. I think I know everyone in the room. Got a couple other folks coming in now. Sorry for the time, we've asked. Game three of the NBA Finals is tonight, and just to assure you, this was planned long before. And to actually take it further, we've been doing a series of town halls recently, all of which have coincided with NBA Finals. So we actually had a pretty decent crowd in Lucas Valley, and I've been very much looking forward to connecting with the Marinwood community this evening. I want to acknowledge Justin Kai, one of your Marinwood Community Services District members, who is hosting the forum this evening. Thank you for the great work.
There's also Isabella here.
Isabella, of course. Yes. Hi. Yes. And do we have Eric here?
Yep.
Yeah, okay, Eric. Thank you for your hospitality, and it's really been a pleasure working with you. Let me start by saying, it's truly been a privilege to serve as your representative. It's been about 18 months now since I've been on the job as a supervisor. I'm enjoying it. Not too many more gray hairs so far, but give that time. But one thing I suspected when I started is this really is a level of government where you can get some tangible things done. Excuse me, my phone is going off, of course.
Is that a good score?
Actually, John, you're going to be our designated looker at the score.
So. At an opportune time, I will chime in.
And for those who don't know, my aide Chris Calloway is here as well. So Chris is part of my dynamic duo of aides that I've really enjoyed working with. I'm also a neighbor. I live right on Las Galinas Avenue. For a number of years, I lived at Casa Marinwood nearby here. So this community really has special value for me. Hey, Cameron. Nice seeing you. I was just going to mention my kids grew up around here and now are actually college age. One just graduated from college last week, which was really exciting. One thing I ran on, and I'll just keep emphasizing, I'm here to stay in close communication with you, to hear what's on your mind. In part, we're trying to do that with these more formal presentations, if you will, around my district, but that goes for, shoot me an email. My policy is to try to respond within 24 hours, personally to email, or a member of my staff will. Pick up the phone, stop by the Civic Center. My home number is listed in case you really need to get in touch. We have a quarterly, or if not more frequent, newsletter. If I don't have your email, please give it to us. We would love to stay in contact with you that way as well. We have a Facebook page, a Twitter feed, and again, all of the above. Let's stay in touch. I want to hear what's on your mind as well. So what I started to say earlier, one of the things that I really suspected when I took the job is this is where you can actually get tangible things done, and that's really proven to be the case on a whole range of issues. What I'd like to do tonight is focus on a few that I think are of particular interest to Marinwood and North Santa Fe, although I know we have some visitors from elsewhere as well, which is great. And by the way, thank you, Stephen, for taping the proceedings. But anything else on your mind that I don't cover, please let me know. And I also don't want to stand on formality. If a burning question comes up during the talk, just go ahead and ask. And again, the idea will be to leave plenty of time toward the end for a Q&A. So the issues I'm going to cover, which will be of no surprise, because really they affect not only our communities in District 1, but the county, are housing, development, and homelessness. Now, I'm going to take an intermission after housing and development, and I'm going to invite Ernest Plott, our public works department, up with, I think, what is hopefully some good news, and that is our paving program for the Marinwood neighborhood during this summer. Ernest will talk for a while, answer some questions, and then I'm going to circle back with homelessness. I know of particular interest to some of late is a discussion of Mark Drive that has come up, which is a site over to the east of Redwood Drive in the Terralinda Business Park. So does that sound like a reasonable agenda? And again, feel free to chime in or raise additional issues later. I'll tell you, we did one of these at Lucas Valley recently. The biggest topic was medical cannabis, and probably the biggest Board of Supervisors public hearing I've been involved in so far related to medical pot. We had about a crowd of 300 people there. It's a hot topic now of interest. So again, we'll hold that thought, and I'll leave that to you if you'd like to discuss what we're up to there. So the housing issue, and again, the issues I'm going to be talking about tonight, these are not issues that are just germane to our communities. You look at the entire Bay Area right now, there's a significant housing issue going on with affordability. There are issues with homelessness, etc. So what's interesting to me is that the things we're dealing with, they're not easy. But frankly, I think that's what makes this job interesting. But it also underscores why I need you. I don't know all the answers. I'm hoping to continue to collaborate with you with some ideas. So I don't need to really remind you folks, over the last 2 to 3 years, there has been a burning debate over affordable housing in Marin County. Issues such as high-density housing along the freeway, just a contentious debate. What I'd like to think is, since I've been elected, the nature of that conversation as a community has changed, and that is working with my colleagues on this board. As many of you know, we had four very productive forums on affordable housing late last year, early this year. The goal being to move beyond that contentious debate and come up with solutions that make sense for our communities in a creative way. And the good news is we have a lot of creative people willing to step up. So one approach, I'm just going to cover a few of the initiatives that we're pursuing, and particularly some of the ones that I'm taking the lead on. One is approach that rather than focusing again on this debate of should we go with high density development, we're looking at a program where we would actually acquire and or rehabilitate existing properties and make them affordable. The idea is that's one strategy to preserve some affordability in the community. And we're off to a good start. This is going to be a public-private effort. The key is to develop a housing trust fund. We already have about $5 to $6 million in it. We're continuing to add to it and attracting private partners in order to acquire some buildings. One example is a project in Fairfax we recently consummated that will actually result in 27 units of affordable housing. Another is 20 units at the Forest Knolls Trailer Court out in West Marin. Keep your eyes out, and you will be also hearing more from us on that issue. Don't need to tell you again, rents are skyrocketing. Year over year, members of our community are facing not just double-digit rent increases per year, but even within a year. It's just extraordinary what is happening here now, and again, we're not unique. So one strategy I'm leading is I think we actually have an underutilized housing choice voucher program, otherwise known as Section 8. And part of the reason that's the case is we have landlords, in my view, that are sitting on the sidelines right now. Why? Because when they hear that term, they automatically worry. Is my unit going to be damaged? Am I going to lose my security deposit? And from the research we're seeing, 9.5 times out of 10, that's just a perception, not a reality. And in fact, there are many mom and pop landlords, and perhaps some of you folks in the room are those now, that have recognized the value of this program as a long-term business play and have participated. But recognizing the perception, what we're going to do is actually create a loss mitigation pool as part of our what we're calling a landlord partnership program. We will actually get what in effect will be an insurance pool put together. And if you're a landlord and you agree to participate in the Housing Choice Voucher Program, and in fact you do have some loss or damage to your unit, we'll cover it. And again, I don't think we're going to have to use it that much. So that's a current budget item. We're also putting into effect a landlord liaison program. So I'm meeting extensively with landlord groups, tenant groups, other stakeholders, members of the real estate community. And one thing we're hearing is, hey, the government is not responsive. If we have a problem, it languishes, no one picks up the phone. And beyond even financial incentives, what we heard loud and clear is, if you have someone who can literally pick up the phone when we call, that's going to be very valuable in convincing us to participate in the program. So we're establishing a 24/7 landlord liaison program as part of the landlord partnership. Okay, so one final thing on, a couple final things on housing. We had an extensive debate on what kind of regulations we should impose. Is rent control the right way to go? As a board, we decided not to go in that direction, in favor right now of going a more voluntary approach. You might ask, why would a landlord voluntarily step up and agree to a lower annual rate increase? Why would they provide more notice? We literally are couching it, and the landlord community is working with us, as a code of ethics, if you will. If you're a landlord in our community, we all need to step up and recognize that it's not all about the bottom line. And you know what? A lot of landlords are responding to that. Plus, they see that long-term tenants and that kind of stability might just make more sense economically than trying to achieve the fast buck. So we're in the process of looking at how best to implement that program, as well as looking at some other regulatory approaches, again, to preserve existing affordable housing. And there's some great examples out in other communities that we're looking at in doing that. More to come on that. We're calling this the summer of getting some housing solutions in place, and I think we're off to a good start. So we'll be rolling out some of these programs toward the end of the summer.
But can you put any kind of limitations on who you can rent these to? I mean, isn't it just open to anybody, whether they're here in the county or have a job here or anything? And so it's just a continuous thing. You make some housing for some people, and you've got more people. And it should be limited to people who actually have jobs here and are coming from far away. But then what's to keep them from being now closer here, and they're now closer to San Francisco, and then go get a higher paying job in San Francisco.
Mm-hmm.
So it seems that, like, until there's some real control on who you rent these to, that it's just a vicious circle.
Yeah, the key is incentivizing it. Again, what can we offer landlords? And that's where these discussions with the landlord community, with the tenant community, have really been helpful. What would be meaningful to you? And we have some funding available. Is it a matter of you know, helping to fix up your units? If you rent to local folks in need, who are working locally, or teachers, etc. So we're in the process. Good questions, Carol. We're in the process of looking at what would be meaningful from both landlord and tenant standpoints in terms of making this type of program work. And again, there's some other examples out there. A couple of communities up in Sonoma County, for example. Again, I'll keep you guys posted on that.
Just so we're clear, 90% of the people in affordable housing work in Marin County. So the statistics are in our favor of supplying the, you know, the space we're living
in. Jimmy, could you repeat that? My phone just went off, which I just saw.
90% of the people that live in affordable housing work in Marin County. So it's a pretty good number. Of course, there's a worry, well, somebody's going to move in and work someplace else. But the numbers are showing us that that's not the case.
No, that's a great statistic. And I think the more we can kind of get underneath the numbers and figure out how to target these efforts, the better. So I appreciate that.
What's the source of that figure? The 90%? I was just curious to see the study. Yeah.
That was a study done in Marin County. If I want, I can get that information today.
I mean, not to do it. I was just curious what kind of study that was.
Hey, Damon.
Yes.
Santa Rosa recently purchased a hotel.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and
yes,
immediately created, you know, whatever it was, 140 some odd units there, or whatever the size of that hotel was. Do we have that ability, and how did they do that?
I think it's a similar model. It's a housing trust fund. Do you recall what they specifically used that for? Was that a homeless program?
No, it's
I know what you're talking about.
Supportive housing.
Okay,
I think
great.
It's that transitionary piece where,
man, so kind of tied into homeless,
right,
alleviation.
Right, right.
Okay.
So they immediately,
yeah,
created, you know, didn't even have to create much because it was there.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there was this hotel that was just kind of languishing and wasn't doing anything. I'm just thinking in Santa Fe, we have a couple of, you know, hotels that if there was money to go to a person and say, hey, you know, buy this. That's, I think, the easier way to get them, you know, not recreating the wheel.
That's right.
Seeing what someone else is doing.
That's right. Yeah. That's, well, right. That goes to the first point I made about,
yeah,
acquisition, rehabilitation. Yeah. Now, if you know of any opportunities out there, please let us know. Because, again, I think it's putting together the right partnerships, et cetera. The permanent supportive housing and transitional housing piece is somewhat separate but related in terms of keeping people housed.
Right.
I have been meeting extensively with Sonoma County on that. Interestingly there, jumping a little bit ahead to homelessness for a second, there's also an effort at the statewide level, including our state senator, Mike McGuire, to put together a $2 billion housing fund for homeless, including with mental health issues. So that's kind of interesting as well. Let me make a couple final points on housing. Another part of what came out of our hearings is we got to make sure our local regulations are actually making sense for the purposes they are in place supposedly to serve. One example is the housing overlay. Which, when you get more into it, is very complex, not very user-friendly, and the feedback we're getting from potential participants is thanks but no thanks because of the level of difficulty of complying. That's exactly what we don't want to be doing. So we're actually looking to, yes, Justin.
So on that, is the housing overlay designation more of a guideline or suggestion, or is it all hard and fast, development has to adhere to X, Y, and Z?
It's a guideline.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, it's a guideline.
All right.
Yeah. We also, of course, want to make sure that we have the ability to pursue options that make sense here locally. There is some concern out in the community about regional agencies, for example, ABAG. What kind of mandates are coming out of there? So one of my jobs, if you will, I'm our ABAG representative. So making sure that our local voice is heard there, very important. Any other further questions on housing? What I'd like to do is touch base on several of, Justin, go ahead.
So two questions on some points that you brought up earlier.
Yes.
On the potential, on the housing trust that you were talking about,
yep.
The funds that are in that, do those funds come from sources that are strictly designated for affordable housing only, or is and any of that come from just the account, the general fund, or?
Both. So it's largely in lieu of fees that historically have been paid by developers.
Yeah.
We actually are also stepping up and putting our money where our mouth is and bolstering the housing trust fund as well with some allocations. And again, the theory being that ultimately these projects will require partnerships, I think, with private parties as well.
And then when a property is acquired, and is it then acquired by the county? That is, does the county then own the affordable housing?
It can be done a number of different ways. Mm-hmm. So that's one option, certainly.
So if it's done that way, does it then continue to generate property tax revenue, or what happens to that component?
That's a great question. I don't know the specifics of the tax policy on it.
Have the supervisors ever considered just really relaxing junior units and in-law units? I think, personally, I think that's a great way to integrate people.
Thank you.
Instead of the, you know, them, us, I think when you get people with different socioeconomic.
Yeah, Justin, thank you for reminding me. That's actually on my outline. That's actually one of the main things we're pursuing. So I covered Section 8, landlord incentives and voluntary steps, if you will. Acquisitions, rehabilitations, making sure regulations make sense. Last but not least, thank you. Second units and junior second units. What are now called accessory dwelling units. For those who are not familiar with it, what it means that is if you have an existing home, and as we know, many of our neighbors even are, let's say, seniors who live alone or maybe with their spouse in a 3 or 4 bedroom home. The junior accessory dwelling unit program actually allows them to refurbish a room in their home with just certain features. And the goal is to keep it simple and not too much red tape, and then they can rent it out. The advantage being, it's no new development. It creates outcome for the seniors. Maybe they need some more money, and it creates more affordable housing. I think one of the housing issues we're facing, more broadly speaking, is we have a lot of seniors living in large homes. That's their right. In fact, we need to make sure they can live in place if that's their decision. But if they want to move to a downsized unit, I think it makes very much sense for us to create more senior housing so they can do that. whether it be a smaller infill project, whether it be a junior accessory dwelling unit, or a more traditional second unit. Yes, so one of our highest priorities that emerged from our housing forums was the junior second unit program and incentivizing that. It sounds like folks agree that's a good way to go.
Okay. Will setbacks, I mean, this is on a municipality's city basis, but will setbacks be eased and things like that? Because sometimes setbacks are mm-hmm. crazy in terms of how much buffer you have to have. Obviously, you want to have some, you know, certain way that things look, and there's a reason why codes are in place,
right,
and so forth. But I just think people assume it's much better to self-police. Mm-hmm. It's kind of mixed in there, integrates, whereas you stack the thing. I mean, that whole Marinwood thing they're talking about,
right,
bridge and whatnot, just wasn't a good idea for them, us, you know, all these other communities.
Right, so you integrate it into
it's
the community.
It's just great, yeah. So you get to know people on an individual basis.
That's right.
Instead of just this, you know, thing.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah.
Tom, versus reducing setbacks, I think what might be more beneficial is increasing the square footage to lot size ratio if you're looking to increase a second unit or something like mm-hmm. that, because that still maintains the distance from your property to property, but it just allows you to build more on your lot. So
we actually have some entrepreneurs in the county that are taking the lead on this program, and it's very exciting. It's catching on at the state level. The legislature is talking about it, but I think the whole point is you want to streamline the process, right, to encourage people. So that's good to hear.
What is the trend now at this point for people applying to do that?
For junior accessory dwelling units?
Yeah, so for like in the last 10 years, how many people in the county have applied?
There's some. It's interesting. The status of where we're at now in the county is it can be done, but it's not a standalone program where someone can go, you know what, I just need to do these four steps to do it. There's one thing over here in the code, there's something else over here. So the directive we put to staff is bring it all together, refine even as need be, and make it a standalone project. We're already getting a lot of interest in it. So that's kind of—
Are you getting out there? That shows changing from this to this will increase the numbers of people that will apply.
I can look for that for you. I think what we're hearing is there's a demand, and we're seeing it where this has been implemented, to the extent that even, as I mentioned, statewide communities are really seeing this as an opportunity. Again, we're not alone. People are looking for creative solutions to creating and maintaining a range of housing for people with different income. So I could try to look for that information for you, but what we're seeing and hearing is there's a clear demand for this kind of housing.
Hey, Damon, so we just did that at the city of Marinwood.
By the way, everyone, John Gamblin, a city council member, who lives in North Centerfield. John, talk about that.
Yeah, so we just did exactly what you're talking about. We had the ordinance in place that allowed for second units, but not for these junior accessory units. It was all kind of lumped in, and it was economically disadvantageous to a person to just change a bedroom into a living unit because they'd have to do a whole permitting of all the stuff. And so we created a very streamlined, decreased cost. I think it's $500 to go ahead and do that. You can go directly to Paul Jensen, and he'll give you statistics on what happened in Santa Fe. Novato and Sausalito have also implemented stuff, but it's all very new. It's all within the last 18 months that these other, you know, mm-hmm. ourselves. Mm-hmm. So you're not going to get a long-term piece. There is demand, as Damon said, for it. That's what people were asking for, the ability to do that, including your question regarding setbacks and how we address those, and making sure that, you know, as long as these things fit in, it was going to be a very streamlined process for folks to do. I don't have the specific numbers, but you can get those very easily from.
I was there for that meeting.
Yeah,
right? I support it.
Yeah, yeah,
right.
So it's, as David says, it's going around a lot of places. So.
Yeah, I really think we're onto something here in terms of thinking of housing for people who may not be set just yet or have a little bit harder time, in a very user-centered way. So the same way you streamline the process for people to make it easy, because you suddenly thinking about this process from the applicant's point of view versus the city agency. The same way, thinking about housing, you know, you have seniors. Like you said, we have a dearth of senior housing, and from what I've been hearing, there is a tremendous interest of staying in the community among friends, yet not having to worry about the 3-4 bedroom house as you were hitting your 80s or 90s.
That's right.
So that's a tremendous opportunity. And I think two areas where we can definitely be looking at is building second levels over shopping centers.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, like the strip mall, like for example, Northgate, was it 2-3 or whatever it is, you know, over Safeway, for example, right? Because a person who is struggling financially may or may not have access to a car. Being close to a workplace,
mm-hmm,
totally makes sense.
Yeah.
So building near centers of employment makes sense. What does not make sense is building a low-income building in Marinwood Plaza, because there is nothing else there. However, building a senior housing over there,
mm-hmm,
may very much make sense, because you have a market right there, you have the community that people may want to stay in touch with.
Right.
So again, just changing perspective from, oh yes, we the government agency have a problem. It's like, what does a person who is 90 now and lives here really need?
Yes.
What, I mean, it may sound patronizing, but I think, you know, just having contact with these people in real life, you know, you have an open line of communication,
mm-hmm,
I'm sure you would have many people,
yeah,
be willing to contribute their perspectives. So again, the seniors, you know,
yeah,
above Marin Plaza, low-income people who may not have a car or means of transportation, they need to be closer where they are. You know, the same way, smart train is, I voted for smart train and I'm kicking myself for it, because it's not going to solve any problems. It's not, because it's one line. Instead of, you know, thinking as a passenger, I'm going to go from my house to somewhere else. I'm not going to the civic center all the time. I need a network of transportation. And if you are thinking of solving a problem from my point of view, provide me a network of solutions,
mm-hmm,
buses, train, whatever it might be, so I may abandon my car in favor of public transportation. So that's kind of my 5 cents about the...
No, it is, and transportation is a whole separate topic, and you're absolutely right. It's huge for our community. I'd be happy to talk about that a little bit more.
About your biking.
That's true. I'm like car free for the month of April.
All right.
Great.
Damon?
Steve?
In the last housing element, second units and assisted living for seniors were not counted as living units. Is that now been changed?
You're talking about the RENA numbers.
The RENA numbers. So I'm just...
Great question. To some extent, but it could be changed more. To count those units, and that's something we'll continue to push on the legislative.
So it's not there right now.
It's not fully where it needs to be.
Okay.
Right now, and I think we implement some of these great ideas. That's going to be important. For those who don't know, the regional housing allocation numbers that the state sets forth. Cameron, if I may single you out for a second, great example of longtime community member who built a second unit, and now a teacher who happens to be your son lives in there, which I think is great. I mean, I think about your family oftentimes.
And we're gonna go upstairs.
Yeah. My in-laws who've lived in Lower Lucas Valley, the Berries, some may say Marinwood, they say Marinwood or Lower Lucas Valley, have lived there 50 years. They're in that situation. They're living in a big house now. So what are their options to the extent they choose to go a different way? Great discussion, you guys. I mean, any of these discussions we could talk all night about. If it makes sense, and we touched on it a little bit with Marinwood Plaza, let me talk about some of the hot button development proposals, because as we know, a lot of things are potentially coming our way in Lucas Valley, Marinwood. Grady Ranch, that's the George Lucas proposal further up the road. And I always like to mention that, so it was about a year ago that proposal came forward. I was but a mere about 3 months supervisor at the time, and a national TV crew shows up at my door. Okay, luckily I just happened to be out of the office that day, pure coincidence. And then it even got better from there. I was actually interviewed by Le Monde, the Parisian newspaper. And for those of you who read French, please feel free to look up my quotes in Le Monde. Because I think anytime you're dealing with a figure like George Lucas, right, it's all news. And there's a colorful history here in the area with him, to say the least. Put simply, no update on Grace. There has been no application, no discussion, nothing beyond literally what kind of was talked about in some conceptual way about a year ago. So that's a real quick update. Justin?
Do you know what the time frame is that they have to update their application before it expires?
They don't have an application.
Or
it never even got to that.
So is there a time frame for whatever they have that they have to update before?
No.
So there's basically nothing that
there's not
to expire at the current time.
I mean, rumor has it he's dealing with Chicago now and some stuff. But is he coming back now? So.
Would you guys did approve the change in use from the office to?
That's next on my list. Okay. Yeah. Okay. So.
Damon, it's so rare I'm ahead of you. It's nice.
No, but you guys are teeing up Isabella now. And Tom, you're teeing up my talking point. So good outline so far.
Exactly.
Okay, so let's talk about George Lucas's Big Rock remodel project. So Mr. Lucas owns several ranches. If you're going west on Lucas Valley Road, right past the Lucas Valley Estates, there's Grady, which is currently open space, Big Rock Ranch, which is a commercial facility and studio for those of you who have gone out there, and then further down the road is Skywalker Ranch, which we're all familiar with. So the proposal was to take part of the commercial use of Big Rock and convert it into overnight lodging. The theory being that in the technology world and the other film and projects they're working on there, folks travel in, work for like a week or pull 72 hours in a row on a project. Rather than having to go to a hotel down the street, they lodge there. It's currently already done at Skywalker Ranch. So it's about 67 units. Some concerns were raised. Traffic, again, theory being it's going to reduce traffic because fewer trips to and from the hotel, etc. But would this be open to the public? The answer is no. Would it become a de facto hotel? The answer is no. There were concerns about what if ownership changes. That was dealt with because now the restrictions run with the property and don't depend on who the owner is. So these parameters will always exist. The master plan has a cap on total number of people who can be there. That having been said, some neighbors, most notably up in Nicasio, raised some issues with the language. Is it still tight enough? Like who? The Lucas folks have indicated a willingness to continue to work through those issues and tighten up the language to the extent the neighbors are raising issues. Beyond that, the proposal went through the Planning Commission. Water issues were studied, traffic issues. And I think at the end of the day, the proposal was deemed to work. And so we approved it 2 or 3 weeks ago. And that's kind of where things stand on Big Rock.
Where do they get their water?
That was a very interesting discussion because the concern was it coming from Nicasio? They can't say definitively. That's why it's going to be important to continue to monitor it. It probably comes from a variety of groundwater sources. But what they're saying and what the studies are showing is that again, going back to the use permit numbers, that it can more than accommodate what they're talking about. But we'll continue to monitor. Any other questions on Big Rock? Okay.
Just one question.
Yes.
Was a concern. It sounds like the project is a little bit different than it was before the Planning Commission. But it has unlimited limited overnight visitors, which is good. And I think George Lucas is a good neighbor, and I don't mind the conversion, but I'm concerned about subsequent owners.
Correct.
Because one of the provisions was unlimited day use up there. If that happens, that could be kind of crazy.
Well, nothing was, so there wasn't any change on that.
Okay.
Yeah. So.
So
they have to abide by the cap, existing cap on combined overnight and guest.
Right, which is something like 700 people.
It's 300.
300, and then 300 staff or something like that.
But the
day use, for example, if there was a festival or something like that, it could be unlimited, basically.
And again, it's not like, you know, a festival, unless there's some sort of relation to the...
I'm sure George Lucas is going to carry on well. It's just whoever the future owner
is. Yeah, no, I hear you, Stephen. So I think that was the point of extending it to the property rather than...
Are you referring to Bottle Rock, West Marin?
Yeah.
I imagine they have to go through some approval processes, but.
We already thought to save it from the Renaissance Fair.
Oh, was that being considered out there?
Oh, yeah, save the
Renaissance
Fair 45 years ago or so.
Okay, so. Before I get into Marinwood Plaza, Oakview, the folks been following that proposal?
Is that the senior place along the freeway?
Yeah, so this was a master plan that came into existence about 12 years ago. And if you can picture, if you get off on Lucas Valley Road and head west and look immediately to your right, there's a sign and a hill. Same property, I forget what it says, but this master plan basically calls for two potential developments. One is a 28 unit subdivision that would be right over that hill, and then another is a senior independent living combined with assisted living complex that would be actually along the freeway. More or less kind of where the CHP outpost is there. The way you would get to that one under the plan is actually get off on Marinwood Avenue, go down, actually it's Marinwood exit, go down Marinwood Avenue, and they would create a bridge over the creek and then go along the freeway and back. These master plans have largely laid dormant since they came into existence. More recently, a potential developer has emerged. He was interested in the senior piece. And they actually are exploring what they may want to do there. My understanding is they had a community meeting here in Marinwood recently.
About a month ago.
Which I think is a good idea, by the way. I think if you're a developer and you have an interest in the community, you should come in up front, talk to the community about what you're potentially interested in, get feedback. This gentleman's name is Rob Eves. He lives in Mill Valley, I believe. Has some partners. He's also met with my office, with our planning staff. The issue is what he's proposing now does not comply with the master plan, which calls for a mix of independent living opportunities for seniors, some affordable, and some assisted living. I think he wants to go all assisted. He wants to expand the footprint. An interesting idea he has is he feels that the units are too small as master plan to expand the units. Query whether he would be able to live within the footprint called for by the master plan. He's saying he can't. So there's some issues there. But that's an ongoing discussion, if you will, or thought process on his part. I have not heard anything recently or since the community meeting, but for those of you there, if you want to give me your impressions, or that'd be great, or certainly let's keep in touch on it.
Is there a guarantee that from Marinwood Avenue with the bridge, it wouldn't then connect to Lucas Valley freeway hoppers or?
That's disallowed under the master plan. Okay. Yeah.
There's a, the main parcel there is actually owned by, on the corner of Lucas Valley, as you are coming off, that's owned by Caltrans. Okay. It's part of the whole thing with we always just kind of call it the Daphne property. It was, Caltrans has the right to that easement there, and at some point they're looking at changing how you get on and off the freeway right there at Lucas Valley. So you wouldn't be able to go through their easement, per se.
Yeah, so, and again, the significance of the master plan is if you're talking about some sort of amendment, because obviously that was a whole community process back 12 years ago, so if you're looking to amend that, you've got to go back out and go through the process.
Damon, on that master plan and or that development, if it happens, is there anything that will happen to our intersections, namely at Marinwood Avenue and Miller Creek, and or Miller Creek and Las Colinas? Are light signals going to have to be implemented, or?
I think it calls for a signal at Marinwood.
Well, it seems weird that if he wants to make them assisted, he wants them bigger, rather than if they were independent living.
Hmm.
I mean, that doesn't make sense.
Good point.
I think at the footprint that was allowed, combined with 150 units, and maybe in conjunction with the amenities that he wants to include, he was saying that the what that leaves each unit to is roughly 300 square feet, and that's what he felt was too small, I believe. So.
Well, I think it's going to be important to be very factual about it. So that's what I'll be looking for in the discussion. Okay, anything else on Oakview?
Oh, so
yes.
If a streetlight is necessary at either intersection, is it going to be community input on whether the community wants stoplights at those, or potentially roundabouts, or you know, other type of improvements? Because if it's an already approved master plan, it doesn't need to go through that for those intersections.
That's a great question. I mean, I assume the answer is yes, of course. I mean, anytime you're dealing with infrastructure and improvements, you look at what would be required under state law for safety, but then you are obviously, and that's part of the whole, what is this going to look like? What are going to be the impacts on the community? And of course, the community would have input every step of the way.
I'm just going to see surveyors in that intersection a lot. Get the little tripods out, and I don't know who it is, private, public, whatever.
That's us. I'll speak about it.
Yeah. Or it's the halftime show.
Oh, okay. It's the road.
Speaking of halftime.
Yeah, I don't want to know.
Yeah, so I don't think we're missing anything.
All right.
108-83, Cleveland. Wow. 25.
Oh. Okay.
22.
It's a good night for the meeting.
Yeah. 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 Well put, Eric. Okay, let's move to Marinwood Plaza, which is obviously been a very hot topic. I mean, some might even say, you know, key to my election, right? So it's something I've been vowing from day one to work on, which I think I have, and Chris has been ably assisting me with a really dedicated group of community members. Because we quickly ascertained that step one to doing anything there, because right now it's dilapidated shopping center. Right, which is not what we want, although a great market. Man, that is a good market. And from what I hear, they're doing really well. So that's all good. But there is a toxic plume left over by a former dry cleaners that was a tenant right next to the liquor store that has created serious issues over time. Namely, and it was a toxin that is really not unique to the dry cleaner that was there. This is an issue that happens all over the place, particularly with dry cleaners of a certain era, if you will, where they were dumping PCE, I think it is, the acronym, in the back, okay? And otherwise disposing of it. The result is, because it's persisted over time, you now have soil vapor from that hot spot moving to the west toward the Casa Marinwood neighborhood. And the way vapor does that is along utility lines. And then the good news is there's been testing in the neighborhood and no elevated levels have been detected there, but right near the edge. And the way you get the attention of state regulators, because interestingly, the Regional Water Quality Control Board is the agency with jurisdiction over this issue. That got their attention. To the east, you have groundwater flowing downhill underneath the freeway into the Silvera Ranch. And so unacceptable levels have also been detected through the groundwater over there. Again, a serious issue. So one of my primary objectives has been to force the issue of the cleanup. We can't do anything without doing that, let alone the health implications with letting it land. So we're making progress. In fact, in April, working with this team of dedicated locals, we went over, I testified at the Regional Water Quality Control Board, and we got a definitive plan approved and timeline. Where step one is gonna be, and vis-a-vis the community, the owner is always responsible. Okay, the dry cleaner long gone, even if the owner sells a property, this owner will always be responsible vis-a-vis us for the cleanup. Yeah. They now have 9 months to do step one, and that's going to be to demolish the strip center building, not the market, which is a separate building, and there's been no migration toward that extent. And then excavate dirt out and remove it to get rid of that source of the contamination. One unfortunate consequence, I gotta tell you, is our liquor store there, Jenny and Alex, who have been there forever, that's not gonna be there anymore. Yeah, so and members of the community have approached me about that. I think we all have high regard for them. I'll tell you, they're business geniuses. I may go in, if I go in there even once a year, they remember you. I think they should be teaching at Harvard Business School. it's a great sales pitch. We're reaching out to the owner though, what will ultimately happen to them, so we'll keep you posted as we hear. But they're now well aware that they're no longer gonna be located at that site. So clock's ticking on the 9 months. You're probably already seeing some activity out there. Let me get my notes on that, which I now have well out of order. Here's some work that's already being done. Digging out trenches for barriers that will cut off soil vapor travel towards Casa Marinwood. That's part of the immediate remediation order. Siding was approved for two new soil vapor monitors to be installed soon. One on either side of Marinwood Avenue to monitor soil vapor heading towards Casa Marinwood. Five new wells on the Silvera Ranch property to monitor groundwater and help define and plan. And of course, as mentioned, preparation for the demolition of the building and excavation of the affected soil underneath.
So what's the deadline
for that? 9 months. So clock started ticking in April. So early next year.
After
for
the
completion. Month. Yeah, for completion.
So after the completion of the demolition and then the excavation, is there a time period where it has to be through the remediation that it has to be open while the dirt's been removed?
I think that's all laid out in the plan, Cameron. Yeah, there's a whole, again, we're not inventing something new here. I mean, there's a way that these are done, and yeah, so.
At the minimum, if there were any developer that wanted to do anything, it would be at least 2 years before they could even apply.
Well, they can apply, you mean apply to the county?
Yeah.
I think there are some interested parties out there. They're monitoring the situation. And again, that's probably just an economic transaction with the Hoyts, right, the current owners. I mean, a new owner could come in and agree to pay for it. Again, that's our issue, is it's still the current owner. But any sort of agreement, you know, they could adjust the purchase price. But, you know, I think, and that's a great segue again, thank you. Beyond the cleanup, which is step one, we really are looking at how can we have a great use there, right? And I think if you go back to some community-led planning efforts from the mid-2000s, which I think did have community support, perhaps before things, in many people's opinions, got off track, you had mixed use, you had community-serving retail, which I think is very important. You had a community gathering place right there. You had some housing. And so I think ultimately a lot of promise there. And I think what we're looking to do is get in a conversation with folks who are interested in coming in and really what makes sense for our community in that mixed use regard. Damn. So that's Stephen, yes.
So we're a bedroom community.
Yeah.
And you know, for integration, for smart growth, you know, the whole concept behind Plan Bay Areas is to keep everything close. What that means is we need jobs and we need commercial here. Is mm-hmm. there any discussion on the county level about developing commercial and business opportunities, economic growth? I think I know the answer, but I'd just like to hear
it. At Marinwood Plaza?
Well, at Marinwood Plaza, but also throughout Marin, because basically all of Marin is pretty much a bedroom community. And one of the issues, I mean, if we keep adding more bedrooms and no jobs, we're going to have a lot more commuters. So it's not really mm-hmm. solving the mm-hmm. issue that it's supposed to solve. So, I mean, I personally would like to see more attention paid on that end of the equation.
I think that's a great point. In fact, we could spend a whole another session on just, you know, ways to do that I think would be really interesting and again reflective of our community. I think we have a lot of entrepreneurial spirit here. You have well-educated folks. You have companies like BioMarin that are coming in and expanding. So you're absolutely right. It's an interesting situation because on one hand, we're now running at about 3.5% unemployment, the lowest unemployment rate in this county in the whole state. It's effectively full employment. On the other hand, you raise some important issues. I mean, in order to sustain as a community, it is good to tap into entrepreneurship here, for example. So it's a topic I've been very interested in. Yeah, and I think, you know, right now even, when that happens, and again, oftentimes it's maybe a one or two person firm or someone working in their home, which we have a lot of. But to the extent you need workers, you have people commuting in from San Francisco, for example. So that creates a whole other set of issues with traffic, et cetera. So to some extent, all of these issues are interrelated. But yeah, that actually happens to be a topic that I'm very interested in.
Somebody said to me just in the last couple of weeks that there was at one time consideration of getting rid of the deli at Mount Lassen and that office plaza and building housing there. Is that something that...
No.
I mean, because there you've got a business thing around all those offices where people
yeah,
work.
Yeah, I have not heard.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay, any other questions on Marinwood Plaza? Obviously, to be continued on that subject. Okay, so Tom,
is there any buyers right now? Because I've mentioned this in the past. Mm-hmm. It's listed on Marcus Millgas website as being you know, development and selling it really well, and not mentioning the Bloom part of it.
Right.
Are there buyers actually on the table at the moment?
Not on the table right now, as far as I know. Mm-hmm. There's maybe different levels of interest mm-hmm. out there. Yeah.
I think they're probably just waiting for the whole thing to be cleaned up.
I'm not trying.
Seagulls.
Unless the price is really good.
No.
Okay.
I have a question.
Yes. Ernest, you're on.
Yes. All right. Perfect.
And my question is,
yeah,
is the same people that paved these streets are not the same people that paved down in Delgado and those?
This is a new contract coming this summer. And as an agency, we're required to award to the lowest bidder. So it's competitively bid, and whoever the low baller is, they get the job. So for the upcoming Marinwood paving, that's to be determined starting in August.
I only raise that question because if you drive on some of the newly paved roads, at one point it was out there on the East Valley Road, but if you go over behind Scotty, some of those new paved, mm-hmm. it's almost as if they paved it so it slows the traffic. It's such a rough road to drive on.
Yeah, I
hope that doesn't exist, even with a low. Are there some formalities as to how the condition of that road should be with a low bidder?
Our specifications are very tight. Respect to road condition. I'm not familiar with that segment. I think that's City of Santa Fe jurisdiction.
It is City of Santa Fe.
So I don't know if they did a slurry seal or a cape seal or some other kind of rubber treatment.
As long as it's smooth.
Sure. So quick introduction. I'm Ernest Kloss with the Marin County Department of Public Works. I manage the engineering division. We have about a staff of 12. And we do about $10 million in projects per year. Some of our recent accomplishments countywide have been like Whitetail Bridge 20 years ago, 10 years ago, Cal Park Hill Tunnel, and the recently opened pedestrian bridge over St. Francis Strait. So those are some of the larger projects. And every year we have a paving program. We've got two projects coming into the Marinwood community this year. This is an overview map, and these are plans for the two projects. I've offered to leave these plans here in case I don't get a chance to answer anyone's questions. I'll also leave some business cards if you guys are impacted by the improvements. Getting a hold of me will get you in direct contact with the inspector and get quicker help for you. So the blue here is recently completed projects from the last 5 years or so. This is Las Galinas, and this is Highway 101 as it comes down. So a good portion of Lucas Valley, some of the berries in recent years, and the green projects are what's coming this summer. This is a bike lane project. The Miller Creek Class 2 bike lanes project goes, if you come down the Marinwood exit, you hit that first stop sign at Marinwood. We'll be doing some intersection improvements there. We're gonna do what's called bulbing out. So we're gonna add concrete to the corners and shorten the crosswalk distance. If you know the intersection, it takes a long time right now to get across on foot. And so adding the bulb outs narrows that intersection down. We're not gonna be narrowing any of the lanes, it'll all still be standard 12-foot lane widths. But we're gonna decrease the time it takes for pedestrians to get across and add those yellow truncated domes.
That exists now, Blackstone and Las Vegas?
Yeah, I believe so, yeah. So we'll be doing the intersection improvement there and then formalizing a Class 2 bike lane from that Marinwood intersection all the way down to Las Galinas. Some of you may remember years ago when the island was widened. So they put a curve into the roadway and they filled the island in to discourage the freeway jumping. So that will be removed, but it won't be put back to two lanes. There'll be a bike lane on the inside and it will be buffered by 2 or 3 feet of white striping on either side. So we worked closely with the cycling community. And they said, hey, you know, there's parking on the right there. And a big problem is when people open their doors and a biker's right there in the bike lane. That's called getting doored, I guess. So there'll be a 2 to 3 foot buffer there to stop the dooring, a 4 foot bike lane, and a 2 to 3 foot striped buffer between the travel lane and the bike lane. So we're pretty happy with the design that we came up with. And that project will be starting in the next week. Question?
When you refer to intersection improvements, were you referring to Marinwood Avenue and Miller Creek Road?
Yes.
So will we be losing the turn lanes?
No, I have the plans. If you want to go specifically, I can hold them up and just show you kind of the rough layout. What we did was preserve all the turning movements. So this is kind of the bulb out, and that's what the surveyors were doing out the other day, is marking out the new curb lines. So this is going to be, this is the existing curb line, we're attached. These are all the existing curbs, and we're going to be taking these concrete ramps and coming out and doing some drainage work and reestablishing the curb line. But they'll still be through lanes, turn lanes, in every direction.
And the northwest section right there, there's a sign in Marinwood. It's an entry sign.
Mm-hmm.
How much of that area, that dirt, will be removed, if any?
I don't know if any dirt is going to be removed. We're going to be adding concrete. So there'll be, if this is an existing dirt area, this hatched area, it will remain. It looks like it's a curb there now. And we're just going to be adding this concrete.
I only bring this to attention because our local Lions Club has spent a lot of money and time and effort planting bulbs.
Okay.
Okay. So when you're removing that, will you save a bulb?
Sure. I think we need to kick the dirt together. Yes. If you wouldn't mind just taking one of my business cards, give me a call, shoot me an email.
Can you just
we'll work with you
point again. Which one's Miller Creek and which
sure.
one's...
So this is Marinwood, the market's on this side, and this is the freeway exit that comes down, and this is Miller Creek Road.
So the turn lanes that I was mostly concerned about is when you're coming off the freeway here.
Sure.
Most of your traffic, there's a significant amount of traffic that's going into turning right in
sure.
this community here. So what's there right now is essentially three. There's one for straight, there's one for turning right, and there's one for left.
Okay.
So by combining the right turn and the straight down into one, I think that's going to create a significant bottleneck there.
Okay.
So
there was a lot of discussion with the bike community about the conflicts here between cyclists and anyway.
I'm more concerned about us as residents.
Sure.
Good.
I get it.
That's what we're dealing with daily, and so on a regular basis, especially during high traffic times, that's what the issue is going to be there. What would probably make most sense if you are going to reduce it down to two lanes is keep a right turn, a dedicated right turn, and then make a straight through and a combined left.
Okay.
On that.
Let me talk with our traffic folks.
Yeah.
That's a simple striping change.
Yeah.
So that's definitely not off the table. Let me talk with our traffic folks about regulations and what
okay.
we can do there. But I don't see an issue with that.
Primarily because there's just significantly less population that's turning left into
sure.
that area. So that would, it'd make more sense to combine those two versus the turning right and going forward.
Okay.
So, yeah.
Let me clarify. You're talking about coming off the freeway.
Yeah.
You want to be careful if you're forcing the turn to right, you're going to be impacting a lot of the commuters that actually don't want to turn right. They're going to turn right.
No. So not forcing them to turn right, but because as it stands, there's three lanes
right
now: one to turn right, one to go forward, and then one to turn left. And if you're going to combine most of the traffic coming off the freeway, is turning right into Marinwood Avenue or continuing on Miller Creek.
Right.
So rather than combining those two
into one movement,
that's the bulk of it.
I'm just more concerned with people coming off, making a right, going through the condos, and then making a left back on the Los Angeles.
That's still complicated.
Just to throw one other thing in here, if there's development going in Marinwood Plaza, then that's going to increase a lot more traffic, and that. I don't know if you want to do this until you know what's going in there. I understand Justin's concern, but there's be concern on the other side as well.
But I mean, as it stands now, the bulk of the community is turning right into Marinwood Avenue. That's
I hear you. We'll look at
and if you've got this assisted living thing where you're going to have more cars going down there, and that you might want to be putting in a roundabout, have you made the thing smaller because you've now put curbs out farther, so there wouldn't be as much room for a roundabout?
What this is a federal grant to improve safety in this intersection. We can't just wait forever for a developer to maybe come. We got to make it safe for cyclists now and for pedestrians. That was the purpose of the grant that we got.
So
if your thing is you want to make it shorter for pedestrians to go across, you could make a right turn lane back where it is now, and then build a little cement thing out there so people only have to cross the little right turn lane, then they have a place to stop, and then they can get over to the cross the street.
It's not desirable to leave people stranded in there because they're kind of in that traffic zone. So
from a safety standpoint, if you go to Las Colinas and Blackstone and you look at what they've done, specifically because Mary Silvera School's right there, it does reduce that space and makes it a lot safer for the pedestrians that are crossing.
Yeah, that was one of our projects. Right. Safer is a school project. So, and the developer would be on the hook with developer fees to make improvements if traffic studies revealed that there would be impacts here. So I know that that occurs all the time.
And you're doing this also, you know, at Greenhouse Lanes, correct?
No, we're not.
You're not.
So the bike lanes and at Las Colinas, so, and there'll be no bulb outs.
How do you control, because that's Miller Creek and Las Colinas is a huge problem for control of traffic at school hours again. And is there anything being done there?
No, that could be our next grant. I mean, we have exhausted the grant opportunity with this project. And this was highlighted mainly because of the bike path that comes off from the IJ, right? It comes over and just kind of dies out. That was one of the main concerns, is that there's no formal bike route, there's no formal bike lanes, so.
Some communities are painting their bike lanes green.
Yes.
Are you going to do that?
No. Well, we looked at doing that, and there's been official guides adopted where you can do it. But it's really for those highly urbanized corridors where you have a lot of weaving cars. And so it makes most sense where you really need to demarcate that bike lane. With this one, I think it might kind of urbanize this really rural community. So we kind of pulled back from doing that and settled on the white striped buffer lanes, which we think will do a very good job of stopping cars from going across it. So
I was at the previous workshop when we were discussing, you know, these different options, and from what I remember, there was a lot of interest in this intersection potentially becoming a roundabout. Is that, why is this being pursued versus that? Because at least a roundabout would, you know, allow that the flow of traffic to turn into that Marinwood area a lot easier. I'm just curious, you know, what. Is that still?
Yeah, it's definitely still on the table for a future project. And while this project may seem to preclude it, a roundabout is much more expensive. It just opened bids for the Civic Center roundabout. It was $4 million, and this is a $500,000 project. So, cost is one thing, but the other part is not really having a good case study. So, I think I'd like to see how the roundabout at Civic Center works. I know that they're really used a lot in Europe. And Mr. Seidler worked with us, trying to get us to embrace that. And I just, our traffic folks are kind of in charge of how these intersections are configured. And the engineering team wants their scoped designs and construction improvements. So I can't really speak to traffic's reasoning for not doing that, but that's kind of my understanding.
Okay.
Speaking of the roundabout that's going in by the Civic Center,
yeah,
by the Veterans Auditorium,
yes.
Correct? Well, I thought that was a bad idea because I'm a volunteer usher there, and all of the people when they exit after performances and everything. And I actually this morning looked up on the internet pedestrian safety using roundabouts.
Mm-hmm.
And it says they're very safe.
Yeah.
Well, I find that very strange because where do you put the crosswalks? So you put them way back so that they're not interfering with the traffic part of the roundabout, because there's so many, you know, that theater holds 2,000 people.
Sure.
And they come all out there at one time because they're parked across the way and everything, and it's a mess. And I just thought that a roundabout was a bad idea.
Yeah, I haven't seen the traffic studies for that project. That is run through our capital division, a different division constructing that project. I'm going to be very interested to see how it functions during those very high volume periods. I think there's going to be a little bit of confusion about who goes where, but it's my understanding that as long as people get used to moving in that,
it has the pedestrians that you're supposed to be doing before, but that seems dangerous. And then at the ABAG MTC meeting last Saturday, Judy Schreiberman, who's on the Las Colinas Sanitary Board.
I know Judy, yeah.
Well, she was telling me about there's some woman architect here in Marin who's come up with a whole plan of building an overpass there for pedestrians, but nobody will listen to her.
Yeah, that's probably also a cost thing. I mean, overpasses, there's a big seismic component to that, which requires deep foundations. So,
I mean, it's for the pedestrian because of...
Yeah, so it is complicated. I know that in the roundabout design, there's a lot of emphasis put on pedestrian visibility, giving them different spots to be while cars navigate, and making the intersections very visible. So I'm not so worried about the safety, but congestion may be an issue during those very peak volume. I mean, we've all been there probably to the fair where it just becomes a mess. So.
Ernest?
Yeah?
If you could explain, coming off of, coming from the IJ building down, and now with this new construction, where will the, where will that bike route 15 or whatever it is, where will that go? And because right now, most of them cross over and go up the south side of Miller Creek Road. Mm-hmm. I'm really concerned that the whole intersection of Las Colinas and Miller Creek, if you're ever there with the crossing guard, Neil Cougamus is going crazy morning and afternoon.
Yeah.
And so if you're going to impact more with the bikes coming and then having him have to deal with that, I understand you got a grant and the money's there to do the work, but I think Justin's comment was appropriate that, you know, we're concerned about the kids, and the worst intersection in the whole community is really taking us to.
Sure. Okay, noted, and we'll look for more grants to accomplish that work and work with the community. You know, I think there's a safe, I don't run it, but there's a safer task force that meets when needed with the CSD folks and neighborhoods. So anyway, the IJ path comes down here, and this is actually the Caltrans property line, so we're not allowed to work on this side. And speaking with cyclists, from a traffic perspective, what cyclists should do is use this new ramp that we're gonna create, get into the roadway, right, because they're vehicles, stop at the stop sign, continue across the intersection, and use the bikes in the great left-hand side. And working with cyclists,
sure.
They said, hey, look, we're probably just gonna go straight and do what we always did, was just blow through the intersection, right? So there is a path for them to do that, but they should stop, get off their bike like the pedestrian, look both ways, and walk their bike across. We all know they're gonna do that. They're gonna do that, right? The other concern that was raised is what do they do when they're coming eastbound of Miller Creek? They blow through the stop sign, diagonal across the intersection, right? And knowing that they're probably going to continue to do that, but stop at the newly created stop sign, like law of existence, we're giving them this white striped guided striping across the intersection so that their path is highlighted and that they come across this intersection and then come up this way.
So, if I understand the design of that correctly, at a peak commute hour southbound, it's going to act as a traffic calming coming off the freeway. It's going to probably help us.
It's definitely going to, what it does when it pinches down the lanes to standard width, it gives you this kind of narrowing effect, so it causes people to pay more attention. They're more looking up and slowing down. So. That's the purpose, is to get people to slow down. We're not trying to increase traffic and create delays. So we will look closely at the request to swap the lanes and go at the recommended configuration. So.
Not that this really backs you, I suppose, but I like Justin's idea of doing the left turn and straight to cross the Marinwood. Now again, this isn't your thing, but from a commute standpoint, turning left actually would help the market and so forth. Just, I don't know if anyone agrees.
Yeah, we'll look
but
at
I mean,
it.
It's, you know, it just is a little bit of my own, you know, my company to get the freeway jumpers and then do the block swing. It's like, you're not going to stop that.
Yeah.
But then it might stop the coffee.
Yeah.
And I think that's just the best compromise from the existing population and just where, you know, because I think it's a valid point to think about new developments, but. Plan necessarily on new developments that have been in the works for 20, 30 years. So I think planning according to the current population and where people are is the best practice. So.
Yeah. So the last thing, I know the freeway jumpers was a hot topic years past. It caused the increase of the median size to dissuade that activity. And removing that median expansion and putting it back to the way it was, creating the bike lane, we realize that there's still, there could be people that are stacking up in the left lane, the freeway jumpers, and then people that get smart, because even though that there's parking lot on the roadway, it's not heavily used, right? So people might be tempted to drive in that parking lane and head all the way down two cars deep, right, and kind of create that situation. So we actually implemented a structure to dissuade that, and that's, as you're approaching the intersection of Las Colinas, we're going to install this berm sort of island structure so that cars would be forced to stop and then weave back in. So this is all this is a curb in the parking lane. It's going to take about two parking spots, which we understand is not really used anyway. And that's going to force cars to stop at this curb and then merge back in if they're breaking the law, driving in the parking lane, driving over the bike lane, really being irresponsible.
Before you get to the intersection?
Yeah, it's right before you get
there. Right in front of the professional center.
Yeah.
Yeah. So that we thought was a good mitigation for any potential lawbreakers. You know, we were very cognizant that that median widening was done on purpose to dissuade the freeway jumpers. And I understand it kind of worked. People don't use it as often.
The biggest thing that worked is sheriff citations.
So okay, enforcement.
Enforcement is the best move here. So.
Yeah.
Can it have the same effect as what they were doing with the PG&E thing for a while and then barricades up? Because then they're like,
Yeah.
So is that like going to be a pharmaceutical effect?
Yeah. So that's the bike lane project. And then real quick, we're doing some resurfacing starting in August on Pinewood, Quietwood, Las Colinas, and some of the stones. That's in green here. It will start in August. The curb ramps and sort of path and travel stuff will go in our best efforts before school starts. So we're really trying to target the stuff that impacts how people walk to school and get to school. And then the road paving will occur sometime in September, October. Our standard outreach practice is notification signs and door hangers on each affected home. So everyone that lives along these streets will get a copy of a notice from the contractor saying how they're going to be affected, when they need to move their cars, and when they need to expect paving. So
is the intent every summer to essentially redo more and more streets throughout the neighborhood?
Yeah, I mean, you can see from this map, we've tackled a lot.
Yeah.
You know, it would be great to get all the streets in Marinwood. Ultimately, you know, pavement has a 30-year design life. A lot of these homes went in the 50s and 60s, these developments. And the asphalt was very thin and it's very degraded. So where we can, we'd love to pave as many streets as we can as county unincorporated. Unfortunately, the resources are so low, we're forced to pick and choose, so.
The plan is to take it all over the very northern end of Las Colinas?
Yeah, this is the cul-de-sac at the very end, yeah.
I would imagine the whole bulbing aspect of the Lemon Creek and Marinwood intersection adds somewhat cost to this area. What made you pick that intersection versus the Las Colinas Lemon Creek one, which is much more vital to community, to the school kids, etc., and much more utilized by children on bikes versus weekender cyclists who just happens to go down to the path?
To answer your question, I didn't choose it. It's my understanding, and I don't have the documents with me, that it was chosen with a Safe Routes to School committee, and the CSD was involved in walking and hearing the community's concerns, and this was raised as one of the top concerns.
So, I would say the CSD wasn't involved.
Was not?
Weren't you more than a person?
Oh, okay.
And yeah. Also, there was no school traffic in that area.
I know for sure, I have a letter from the CSD supporting the Safe Routes to School application for a lot of the improvements you're talking about. I think it was 20 curb ramps. You have a lot of informal paths in between streets the kids use, and there were 20 curb ramp locations identified as needing replacement and increased signage.
Do you know what year that was?
There was in public.
December 2nd, 2014 was the day of the letter. Anyway, it said we're supportive of the application. The point being is we're implementing a lot of those improvements as part of the paving project. So there's this informal path that goes between Quietwood Pinewood, So there's curb ramp replacements going in here and curb ramp replacements going in here, higher visibility corners.
Yeah, I'm just an advocate of allocating the limited resources to in such a way that it would benefit the largest number of people affected or largest number of residents. And
sure.
I don't necessarily think that it lasts here, but
okay.
It's
sure. I can pass that message back to our traffic folks who meet regularly with the Safe Routes to School Committee and make sure you guys are involved in future applications. So.
I would also agree with what she said there. The Miller Creek and Las Galinas is the most concerned because it involves children.
Another really critical intersection is Idleberry and Miller Creek. And unfortunately, the crosswalk that goes right through the median strip, which is not a crosswalk. There's a curb there.
Yeah.
So I don't know whatever's going to happen with that, but that's a problem for all the kids who come to school moving back and
forth. I know there's a lot of issues. I mean, there were recently bike lanes were put in on Idleberry. We had the bulb out project in front of Mary's Fair School.
This is just a crosswalk.
Yeah, yeah. I'm saying that. Right. The standard process is for the traffic folks to meet with the Safe Routes Committee and walk. I don't know who's on that committee, but they kind of flesh out these projects, and then they come running to me and they go, we got grant, we got priorities, please go build it. So I'm happy to deliver this project for you. I'm happy to look at, with traffic, looking at delivering more projects.
And your grant will replace the bulbs.
Yeah. We will talk to you about the bulbs, all right? You guys.
Down Miller Creek towards the community center. So I just wanted to put my two cents out there in terms of public safety on Miller Creek right in front of the community center.
Mm-hmm.
There was a substantial effort to put a stop sign at the crosswalk right in front of the fire department, and actually the chief supported this idea because it did not affect the way the engine would be pulling out of the firehouse. And the traffic folks at your Department of Public Works came, measured, decided that there was no safety issues as the cars go down 40 miles an hour from Lucas Valley Road onto Miller Creek without stopping for people who might be on the crosswalk. The crosswalk is marked. It has a yellow sign, but I've been using this crosswalk many times, and many times that I have to hold my kids for dear life because we've been really told by the agency that unless something critical happens, there's really no reason to do anything. So I am not volunteering my children as victims for something to happen, but I would really look to you for a more for more consideration in terms of this crosswalk, because again, we don't want to have children dead here, especially during summer camp. We're looking at 200 kids here.
Sure.
And people do park across the street, and then the good people who have patience actually walk on the crosswalk. Others just cut across. And again, many, many times have I seen cars do.
So what forum do we meet? Who do we meet?
Well, it sounds like you've had a dialogue with the traffic department or Bob Gralka, John Neville.
Greg Tackerberry.
Greg Tackerberry.
Greg Tackerberry?
Was the one who absolutely said no. He's the master of no in my
opinion. All right. He's one of my bosses, so I'll go back and manage up.
So if you could just pass that on.
Sure, no problem. I can ask around about the issue and why the warrants for crosswalks, and there's all kinds of traffic lingo and restrictions and requirements.
Yeah, I'm making some notes as well.
Don't
so,
forget, I work for the child. So
I was going to say, maybe I can help.
Yeah.
Learn it.
Yeah.
Get through some.
I'd be happy to look at it.
Thanks for that.
Sure, yeah, and I'll leave the plans with CSD so you guys can get down into the meat of them. I really just want to thank you in advance for your patience as the jobs progress.
That's why the big signs are up there.
Yeah, the changeable message boards went up recently, and it's just going to be messy and disturbance for a while, but it'll be all finished before it starts raining again, and we'll be in good shape. So.
And the letter that you're referring to from the CSD, if you could maybe get that to us here to the district manager.
Sure, I got a copy.
Okay.
It was attached to the back of the Safe Roots application. I think it's the last page. Anyway, just said we're in support of the Safe Roots app.
Yeah.
It shows all the improvements in there with exhibits, so.
And generally, it's my understanding that pathways or roads, like the actual roads itself, are not part of our jurisdiction or responsibility, but okay. You know, I'm sure you know, we'd be happy to be notified of meetings that go on or anything like that, so.
Sorry, the Safe Roots Task Force?
Well, just regarding, what we've been talking about.
Sure.
In terms of any of the decisions that are going on or anything like that. So,
No problem. I think that would, I'm not trying to throw them under the bus, but that would fall to the Traffic and Transportation Division that runs the outreach that, I think there, with so many jurisdictions, we have 421 maintained road miles and many different community groups that they work with. It's kind of, they're always in catch-up mode. So if you don't put the request in, they're kind of going, they're happy of course.
And that's what I'm saying is that, if they can make sure to just notify some of these meetings are going on, then at the very least, listen and
sure.
Just be aware, so.
Okay, good. And then I'll just mention real quick, we got a federal grant to soften the curb going up to Big Rock. So you all might remember when the paint truck lost its back end and closed the road for a week or so. We got a federal safety grant to install a retaining wall and fill in that hole and soften that curve up. So that'll be coming in the next 2 years. It's in development now. So that's good news for many.
Fun curve for motors.
Yeah.
Thank you. Any other questions for her?
Now I'll leave the stack business card if you guys want to grab some and review the plans and please do don't get the police call if you guys have any questions.
Are you aware of any accidents on safety passage between Las Colinas and Los Gamos since the sidewalk
went in? I'm not, but I don't track those, so I can't say that there haven't been, but we love putting that project in.
It was 8 years overnight success.
Who cuts the willows that are taken over this night?
Some veg management is needed, but
some vegetation management.
Yes,
we just wish it wouldn't take so long to get something done when there were so many accidents out there.
Sure. Yeah. I don't know who cuts the willows, but
it does need.
Okay. We can look into that.
All right, everyone. I'm mindful of time, so the last topic I was going to cover is homelessness. And thanks, guys. Particularly, there's been some publicity around Mark Drive of late, so answer any questions you have. Maybe real quickly, in a couple minutes, just to set the stage, we all know homelessness is a huge issue, not only here in our community, but really Bay Area-wide, nationwide right now. It's a complex issue involving a lot of different situations. One thing I've emphasized, and particularly my district, by the way, which includes downtown San Rafael as well as North San Rafael. So one thing I've really emphasized while being in office, this is a countywide issue. It's something we all have to address, not just San Rafael. So particular issues that I feel the county owns, if you will, are the mental health system, and since I've been in office, we've actually increased the county mental health budget by about $10 million. It's now $59 million. The key, that's a chunk of change, and the key is going to be to make sure we're spending that money wisely, particularly vis-a-vis the mentally ill and the homeless population, which is a huge part of the issue along with substance abuse. Another piece is the criminal justice system. I think right now we're actually in a situation where oftentimes we're faced with a revolving door. We have people walking our streets with severe issues, and too often they're in the back of an ambulance or a police car. They go to jail, they're back on the street, they're back in the ambulance, they're back in the police car. So what I'm doing is actually convening the key people that need to be in the room in terms of that broken system, if you will. And that includes the DA, the public defender, sheriff, police, service providers, etc. And another key piece, and I think we're making strides in this regard, is this is really a situation where jurisdictions have to cooperate with each other. Again, this is not a Santa Fe only situation. It's the county working closely with Santa Fe and with other jurisdictions around the county. And I think you are seeing that more and more now. And ultimately, all of us are going to have to step up and do that. So one big issue right now downtown is the intensity of services, the growing homeless population, and impacts on neighborhoods and downtown. Much of this is focused on Ritter Center, which is a service provider that provides very essential services, along with other service providers, such as St. Vincent's. But the issue is, and it's been going on for some time, Ritter has outgrown its space, perhaps because of a situation where Ritter is downtown, other services are downtown. The cumulative impact is of concern right now. So the city has been working with Ritter through the auspices of its use permit to address that issue. What is the best way to deliver services in a way that balances everyone's needs and concerns? So John, feel free to chime in here, but as of Monday night, the council took the step of agreeing with Ritter to negotiate a memorandum of understanding where some of the services currently provided by Ritter will be relocated elsewhere. Primarily the mail service, food, and showers. In my view, the county also needs to be a leader. Again, going back to we're all in this together, the county's unique role vis-a-vis a lot of what we're talking about. So we are going to be working with the city. One example in the case of showers is perhaps mobile showers, going to where folks are, whether it's in Southern Marin, Central Marin. As we all know, there are some services up in Nevada as well. So that's one piece. Ultimately, there's also an issue of should Ritter be relocated? And if so, where? And what combination of services should be in that new location? So one potential idea emerging, and we're looking at a lot of different examples, how other communities are addressing these issues. For example, there's a in Palo Alto, an example called the Opportunity House, or Opportunity Center, which has a combination of a multi-use day center where you have job training, you have case management, connection to services, and then permanent supportive housing. There's another example up in Petaluma. What are the best practices? So one potential issue is whether it makes sense, rather than to have a lot of these services concentrated yet scattered near downtown, to find a suitable site for a multi-use center of some fashion. A number of different sites are being looked at by Ritter, by the city, and again, the county is involved as I think we should do, along with other possible service providers. It's tough. I mean, there's not many sites around. In many cases, where some have been pursued, like for example, one that comes up a lot, and I've seen this on social media. What about Marin Square, which is down by Bell? And that site, which I think actually would be good, pretty central, near transit, is owned by Sutter Health. And their plans are very much up in the air. So they're not willing to sell over this right now.
Hi, Jim.
Hey, Joe. Good to see you.
Good to see you. So you mentioned earlier about talking about balancing the needs and concerns.
Yes.
Of everybody involved.
Yes.
So I'm wondering how far along is the process in terms of choosing a location to, if it's going to happen out of Central San Rafael.
Yeah.
Or expand from Central San Rafael.
Right.
And then secondly, what's the logic from the standpoint of the needs of the people who need the homeless assistance to put them in a location like Mark Drive, where it seems to me that that's pretty remote as far as a central transit alternative.
Yeah.
So I guess I'm throwing in a couple of questions there.
Yeah,
one,
yeah.
Where are we in the process?
Yeah.
Two, what is the system so far for balancing the needs and concerns?
Yes.
Because the only thing I've heard about is through Nextdoor and Marin.
Right. And that's such a reliable source of information. Yeah. It's actually good. It serves a purpose.
You know, and my dad just recently signed on to that.
Yeah.
And this is my first meeting in a long time.
That's right.
Make more, but it seems like there are a lot of people who have a lot of questions.
Yes.
And would like to have input.
Absolutely.
So I'm throwing three or four questions at you.
No, all good, John.
Thank you.
And let me just preface it, going back to the point I made at the beginning of the meeting. The way I operate is there's community input and dialogue every step of the way. And decisions as big as where to put services, doubly so. And by the way, next door, I get reports of, it's actually helpful. One particularly noteworthy comment I heard, along the line, it encapsulates a couple of your questions. It's like, if we have services in one area, and there's, let's say, issues or impacts, what value is there to simply moving that two freeway exits up, right? So unpacking that, first of all, to answer your main question, we're very early in the process.
Yeah, it's just that I read about a memorandum of understanding. When I see something like that, that
really
gets my attention. Because
good,
that means
good.
It's pretty far along.
No. So remember what that involves.
It's without a lot of input, it seems, from a lot of people in the area.
Okay, so remember what the MOU covers, because I think it is actually good for a step. It's only going to address food, showers, and mail. Okay? So that's, in my view, separate from the issue of are we going to physically relocate renter one? Two, if so, and by the way, I think there are a lot of rationales for relocating renter. Two, in the new location, will there be a co-location of other services, i.e. some sort of multi-use center that may include a food piece, case management, job training, etc. So that's another big decision point. We're early in the process. There's no location that's been identified that would meet the needs. And by the way, I think you touched on a couple of other really key points. Anywhere services are located, there has to be a concern. Is it safe? Are there controls? Is it actually meeting the objectives of providing effective services? Is it near transit? Are there unacceptable impacts on neighborhoods? And, you know, I would put it this way. Not only is it a situation where, you know, we should get community input, I personally am counting on it. Again, I think this type of problem rises to a level where we're all in this together. We all have to be coming to the table with ideas, et cetera. So, notwithstanding anything you've heard on next door or in the press, although I think the press kind of corrected some perceptions, there's been no agreement, there is no process underway, there's discussions. There are some other sites as well.
What is the best way to stay on top of it in terms of information?
So, obviously, I will I'll be continually putting out information.
Andrew Henning's blog is that you can subscribe to.
Say that again.
Andrew Henning's blog that you can. He keeps updating that weekly. Andrew Henning is the new gentleman that the city of Santa Fe hired.
We're working closely with Santa Fe on this. So one other thing, and then I'm going to open it up to questions. Another piece is the REST program. Okay, so that's a rotating emergency shelter. A great program. Right now, that rotates among congregations throughout Marin County. It's very, very highly regarded. The REST program, and it's administered through St. Vincent's, which also does a soup kitchen downtown, and the Marin Organizing Committee, which is a group of congregations, is stating that they're no longer willing to do it after a couple more years. They've been doing it for a few years now. That's something we're considering. Again, though, here's my view right now. I think if you're talking about taking all the services of Ritter, and again, maybe we have to reimagine, rather than getting fixated on what Ritter is now, maybe with the MOU, with some other policy decisions, that looks different. But as things stand, if you're looking to have the whole REST program, all of Ritter, all of St. Vincent's, all in one location, that's a big situation. I personally am nowhere near that right now in terms of decision making. So, arrest is an issue out there. One final piece, that's the emergency shelter situation. The ultimate policy solution to what most people are saying now is we also have to look at permanent supportive housing. That is another county issue, and that has to be looked at countywide. Okay, so those are just some parameters. Justin and then Carol.
So, just to be clear, because I think my understanding of this is that the IJ kind of got ahead of themselves with what they initially
published.
So, to me, it seems like what you're saying is that the combination or parts of the service, you have not expressed support for those at 67 Mark Drive, correct?
What I'm saying is, and what was reported is somehow full rest. Full Ritter, as now conceptualized, all being put there without even getting into an analysis of what makes sense,
or the process, or
interacting with the community, or evaluating all the parameters I just talked about.
Yeah.
So yes, that's absolutely right.
And just a follow-up question, is there an investigation into a potential site in an area that I would think would fit the needs of this well, but then also be in an area that essentially void of an existing residential community is the area, you know, past the targeted Home Depot along the 580 North on your way out to the Richmond Bridge. It seems like that's a fairly industrial area that's comparable to where, you know, they're wanting to be south of Smooth Branch Road, but that's just not surrounded by existing communities.
Yeah, I have not heard, I think out there might be a potential for a smaller site, so yeah, I mean, it could be part, but again, a lot of it depends on what's available, who's willing to negotiate. We were looking at another site, Windward Way, which is very near the Health and Wellness Center. It's multiple parcels.
Well, it seems like that area would be much more accessible to Central San Valley, if that's right. What you're trying to accomplish.
Again, is there a willing owner? Is there, so it's all of it. And also, again, what makes sense to co-locate where, et cetera. So it's
complex. I can Carolyn Leonard. The first criteria, I had trouble when I met with the city understanding the established criteria that city employees are now working on at the behest of the mayor to help these organizations find new locations. So our tax dollars are being, and time is being taken away from planning and other things in order to see if they can't get a little traction on this question. So
I think that's in part. The other piece is they were working to evaluate existing services at current river impacts, and then you have the result.
Okay. So I was just speaking to the planning staff has been tasked
correct.
To health and planning.
That's my understanding as well.
But my
it's really just one person. It's really just Rafi. So it's not.
Oh, it's Rafi.
Not a whole staff, and most of the stuff is being done by volunteers on the city council, like myself.
Oh my gosh!
Tapping into city resources.
I did not, my background is real estate for a gajillion years, including corporate real estate. Got to build Pacific Bell Park. By the way, it's been renamed. I know there's some sports fans here. Pacific Bell Park has been renamed. It's Willie Mays Field. We're all done with the phone company. So, meanwhile, at the very top of the list in the order of human need is safety, and you spoke to that.
Correct.
Thank you for it. I want to take it one deeper. The site at Mark Drive is on land subject to very high liquefaction. And that's old construction, so if it's tilt-up concrete that I think it is, it's going to fall down and it's going to sink into the ground and it backs to a creek. And it's also downstream of a toxic site that was never cleaned. So putting people with the fewest resources at the highest risk makes no sense to me, and much less the lovely people doing their best to help. These are not safe, that's not a safe location for human habitation, for 24-hour occupancy, for earthquake safety, among other things. So if that could just float right to the top of, let's not put these people in unsafe locations.
Damon, if I could, just so you understand it, as Damon very clearly put, it's very early in the process, regardless of what is printed in the IGA. Any property that Ritter or any other entity wants to access or move to is a private party transaction. The city is not brokering a deal. The county is not brokering a deal between a buyer and a seller. Where the city and the county hold, depending upon where this transaction and where we are input will be, is on use permit and zoning. So, you know, we're getting very far in front of ourselves, and yes, it got out there that Mark Drive was a potential site, because for those of you who know in the commercial part, Mark Drive has been for sale for about 7 years. It's a property, it's like many others that they've looked for, that they said, hey, could this work? It's 20,000 square feet, could they co-locate things there? Before they would enter into any agreement to purchase the property, if they're any sort of business savvy, they're going to make sure that the uses that they want to go there are going to be approved and compatible for that site, which means they have to go through the process of making an application for uses and zoning at that park, which would go through our planning department, and that would go through certain steps.
and they would probably enter into an option to buy pending the approval of those certain services, because no one would want to buy a property and then show up and then the city come back and say, sorry, you can't do that there.
It's reassuring to hear that, but I think the reason that a lot of people get a little touchy in this particular area is that for some reason this corridor, this media area where we live, seems to be the path of least resistance.
Sure. Well, judging from the input that I get, and I'm sure Damon gets, it's not very least resistance that we're hearing for, which is great because the community does need to provide input on that. I see Mark Drive from my balcony. So I'm right on the other side of Wascalinas Creek there. So I see it, it's there. I'm not making judgment.
And I'm a neighbor.
Yeah, and you're not making judgment any one way or another. And what I want to make sure you guys understand that this is a process and it is not going to happen overnight. And whether or not Mark Drive is even a feasible option for certain things, we don't know. There has not been an offer made. There has not been a counter offer by the buyer and the seller on this property. It is one of many, and I'm saying many, one of several that they're looking at. They're looking at, you know, Windward Drive, as Damon mentioned, you know, looking at pieces down by, you know, off of 580. It is a difficult piece for an entity like Ritter or St. Vincent's to find. They've indicated the willingness to move. St. Vincent's has. St. Vincent's has said, you know, if there is a turnkey operation that serves their clientele, that could make sense for them to move away from downtown as well. But finding those locations is the challenge.
Well, that's somewhat reassuring. I'm going to triangulate comments here. And Damon's saying, you know, you've got to talk about needs and concerns.
Right.
Justin's comment about, what about process? Mm-hmm. And then your comment about, you know, things that I would never even thought of, which is the liquefaction issue and the toxicity issue. So as long as there's process, you know, that's the key thing. Okay, then we balance those needs and concerns.
And the first thing that we're doing, and what we did on Monday night, for the 300 or so that were in attendance, we're here until 11 o'clock at night, but the process is starting, and this is a good sign between what Ritter is doing and what the city is doing and what the county's interacting, is we're not necessarily going to have a meeting every day with this, but they are actively seeking for a way to provide, to create less of an impact on where they are and potentially less of an impact on anywhere they might go. And one, you know, when you have services like shower and laundry downtown, that constitutes, could be 40 visits per day of using that. If that service is taken away from that downtown and put on a mobile platform, which is one option that we're looking at, and moved to Novato on a Wednesday, and to Sausalito for the anchor outs on a Thursday, and to somewhere else that they can go to where the people are, it takes away the intensity that is in that one location. The mail services that are servicing about 150 clients right now, if those could be dispersed, the food pantry, there's some 50 different locations within San Rafael that distribute food. Does it need to be in that same location? So if we can disseminate those out so that you don't have a lot of things happening all at the same time and all in the same place, we hopefully will see a decrease in some of the issues that are taking place there. And going forward, should Ritter find another place outside of the city or in the county or wherever, what uses are going to be there and what's that going to look like? Because you're absolutely right, and I am full. I don't want to pick up a problem, and Damon is saying, I don't want to pick up a problem, just move it somewhere else. That doesn't make sense.
It's not even an option.
Right.
And we've seen good examples. I mean, Homeward Bound.
Right.
Yeah.
And I'm all for Opportunity Center again in Nova.
I'm all for listening to the needs and concerns of whoever the driving force is in Central San Rafael. Maybe it's the Merchants Association. Maybe it's a big corporation that decides that they would like a better environment. But I also would like to balance that against our needs and concerns.
Absolutely.
So,
John, you mentioned the concentration of services that are in San Rafael and the opportunities available. And it's my understanding that most of the services are concentrated primarily in San Rafael and some in Novato. Is there any way to see if other jurisdictions will step up and be able to offer something more interviewing?
Sure, there's always those options, and there's nothing that's, like Damon said, there's nothing off the table. And so, but you have to also look at that between the populations of Novato and Santa Fe, you constitute over 50% of the population of each county. So it would make some sense is that that's where most of the population of the homeless are, between Novato and Santa Fe. I mean, you saw that they have their anchor outs, and, you know, but you, I agree. Are we going to take...
Are other sites being considered outside of Santa Fe?
When I asked the director of Ritter Center a couple months ago, were you looking at other places? They had not. They had looked specifically in Santa Fe. And I followed up that question and said, why not expand it? So I can ask that question. That being said, you know, people will throw things out there that probably aren't ever going to happen. Like with Branson moving out to Strawberry, there's a great campus in Ross.
Yeah.
We move there, you know. you know, it's not really central to a whole lot of things and transportation and whatnot. So you do have to have some logic around it and say, where is it best?
Well, and again,
Justin, what's good is it though?
Sure. I'm sorry, I just really have to focus. My kids are at their friend's house.
Yes.
I really love this one word you used, reimagine. And I think as long as we are providing fragmented services that are scattered geographically, we will be pushing those smelly people that no one wants to be around from one address to another. And we're not going to solve the problem. The problem is that these people need additional help. For many cases, it's a mental issue. And I love the idea of having a safe place for them, appealing to the, you know, the primary need of safety, where they can sleep in a clean bed and not fear for their belongings or their health, where they can shower, where they can eat, they can get their mail, but also they can maybe receive some kind of job training where we don't necessarily feed them all the time, but we will be able to have them fish for themselves at some point, and to a certain extent. That's why, in my opinion, it is critical to combine the services, because if you are addressed in a comprehensive way, then the reaction from the neighborhood will be very different, because you're no longer feeding the homeless or showering the homeless. You are actually developing human beings and helping them, you know, being a halfway, whatever you call it, I don't know, but really make sure that we can utilize their full potential. Yes, it's assisted, and yes, we taxpayers pay for it, but we're human beings, and that's what we do. Again, my big message for tonight, I guess, is the user-centeredness and looking at the end user, what he, she needs, and looking at the problem from their perspective, and providing services this way.
Can I give this brief history of what's going on? Years ago, like 2010, I went to the gym of Nautilus and applied some motion by connecting on 4th.
Yeah.
You know, I parked in the little parking structure at the bottom after I closed up shop. And I walked through the corridor, and I noticed more and more homeless people as I go by, and I'm like, what's going on? So I was just trying to figure out why is there an influx? If unemployment's going down, then homeless is going up. Is there like sort of this word that gets around, like, hey, Santa Fe, you know, hey, guys, come over here, or whatever. I'm not trying to say that I should judge. I've never been in that position, so I'm not going to start judging people. But I'm just, all of a sudden, I mean, they broke one of the windows of the gym. Where did this come? I don't understand how this came to a head.
I think, you know, I'm not necessarily an expert on that level. I would think it's a combination of factors. Reflecting the complexity of the issue. I think you truly have some folks who are now down on their luck. They lost their job, they got priced out of their apartment, so they're on the street. You have that aspect. You have people who are addicted to serious drugs, and that's a growing epidemic nationwide. you have a mental health system where we do need to do more. And in fact, again, to reiterate, that's one area where the county really has to own it and lead. And we are even instituting programs now where it's like mobile crisis units going to where these people are. I heard an amazing statistic recently. Literally, when you look at who is causing most impacts in downtown Centerville right now, it's about 35 to 50 people.
Yeah, exactly.
Which is amazing.
It's about 10% of the homeless population.
And so one thing we're doing, it's based on a San Mateo County model, is what's called a homeless outreach team. Again, literally identifying, naming those 35 to 50 people on the list and intensively addressing them. Housing, services, etc. There's another piece, though, and that is I do think there is a segment, and you're seeing it downtown, oftentimes younger with dogs, that are creating an environment where people are uncomfortable coming downtown. That's unacceptable as well, wherever they may be from. So it's not a one size fits all. I think we need to address it all, frankly. But I think it's a combination of, yes, some people may be attracted right now to these services. I imagine many are from here, but for a variety of circumstances are in that situation. I'm a proponent of Laura's Law, for those who have been following that debate. I was on the losing end of a 4-1 vote not to implement Laura's Law right now. That would be an added tool in the toolbox for severely mentally ill that would allow family members and service providers, if they meet the criteria, i.e. within the last couple years, have had a certain number of arrests and or hospitalizations, create a danger to themselves or others, can be brought before a judge. And in effect, it's a form of coercion. Take your medication.
But they can't force that.
Correct.
Well, that's the one of Reagan years. And then ACLU is what brought the lawsuit against that, not Reagan himself.
Yeah, so you can't actually, we heard from the back, you can't, one issue with this is you can't force them to take their medication unless they rise to the level of what's called 5150, which is imminent danger to yourself or others, then potentially subject to a 72-hour hold. So right now, there is some talk amongst the public of petitioning to have Laura's Law reconsidered. I think that's another tool to look at right now.
At that ABAG MTC meeting on Saturday, I heard one of the people there representing either ABAG or MTC and saying, I overheard him telling someone that he rode the smart train from Santa Rosa to Petaluma, and there were about 30 homeless camps along the railroad camp.
Yeah, that's one of the things that SMART's dealing with.
Yeah,
that's a good issue. When the actual passenger traffic happens, that is a safety issue that they will be dealing with, obviously.
My concern, one concern I haven't heard brought up, is the community effects. If we do locate homeless services up here, the people that can't get in the programs or whatever, they're going to be out on the streets. We've had problems with homeless encampments, fires in this area. We don't really have an enforcement staff to deal with it. We're dealing with open space rangers, and our fire chief goes up there. So, I mean, I don't want us to have to deal with drug use in our parks and homeless encampments. And I mean, it's going to be a problem if we don't look at this comprehensively.
Well, and that's what we are. I mean, it's
and that was part of my list, is what are there unacceptable impacts? You have to take all that into account.
If you look at it, if you just, as Damon said, probably a really good example is the Opportunity Center in Palo Alto, where they had a downtown that was being taken over by homeless. And it's about a $50 million project to get what they did. And they had grants from the Palo Alto Community Foundation to do this. And they didn't really necessarily move it that far out of downtown. It's only about a third of a mile away from where the downtown was.
It's definitely out of
it's
downtown.
Definitely, it's not on the main street, University Avenue, but it's outside of there. That they've been able to create a situation where the impact has been significantly decreased on University Avenue in the downtown, because there are services provided in a single location, and there's things for them to do so they're not out wandering. There's the permanent supportive housing that's there, so they're not just going out. Is homelessness going to be ended? No, but it has been a significant decrease. Challenge location, challenge finances, can it be done? Of course, but it's also time. That is not going to happen tomorrow or the next day. That's a longer term project, but it's not. It is something that we are looking at as well.
I've been concerned about the homeless problem, and there is the physical aspect of Marin County having 80% open space. You have 80% open space, you have lots of opportunity for camping or encampment. So it is no surprise that people take advantage of those opportunities whenever they have no permanent shelter. You are talking about comprehensive wraparound services, essentially looking at all the aspects of the needs. And that's one of the hallmarks of Laura's Law, is it requires comprehensive wraparound services, and it has a lot of accountability. So this afternoon, I read the analysis by, I believe it was RBC, the consulting firm, about why the county doesn't want to implement Laura's Law. And it was sort of a circular argument. We start out with Marin County having, as I understand it, 17 mental health beds available. 17 for a population of 250,000. The county itself plans...
I think you're talking about psych emergency services.
Psych emergency, yes. And the county itself plans for 75 additional beds over the next 5 years. So that essentially means that we have, say, 25% of the beds that we actually need now. We only maintain about 25% of the beds. And then the Marin report went on to say, well, Laura's Law would only help about 14 people, something like 7 to 14 people, because according to the criteria that the consultant in Marin County established themselves, it would only help that number of people. But the criteria were set by Marin County, and they were very restrictive criteria. So it's a little bit like saying to a consultant at the beginning, we'd like to have this result. How can you give us this result? If you read the report carefully, and it's abstruse, as they tend to be, but it is an exercise in how do we get to where we want to go, and where the report wanted to go, it appears, to me, my opinion, the report wants to go to the place of, we want to implement our new programs ourselves, and we want to maintain control of our funds. But never in the report was there any mention of funds which are available for assisted outpatient treatment. Could you address the funds that might be coming to the county if Laura's Law were implemented?
I'm not aware of any specific funds that would be coming, but I guess I would also reject the notion that somehow by implementing the other programs that makes it prohibitive to also implement Laura's law based on finding. So I never fully bought that argument. We are going to be getting a report from our Health and Human Services Department this month on that issue, because that argument was raised. We're going to do these other programs, they cost money, ergo, we can't do this right now. So I suggest please come, as well as other interested persons, and really put that issue on the table.
Next week?
I believe it is, actually, yeah. Carol?
Well, after yesterday's election and two incumbents remaining in office, do you think anything's going to change?
In terms of Laura's law?
No, in terms of anything in general. Do you think you will get any more cooperation?
I have a good working relationship with my colleagues. That's not to say we always agree.
Right.
But I have found that if you're willing to exert some leadership and bring people along, you can get things done. Again, Laura's law, unfortunately, I was on the wrong end of a 4-1 vote. That happens at times.
You're on the right end.
Yeah, right end of the 4-1. So in that case, though, interestingly, petitions are being circulated by the public. So that may result in a situation where the board is asked to reconsider its vote by virtue of public ballot petition. So that'll be interesting.
Damon, when you go around, you ask communities what they might be willing to do?
In terms of what?
In terms of the subject matter. That
Laura's law?
No, the homelessness. So, I mean, to me, it'd be going out and saying, well, what are you willing to do? Stephen just said that they have the same problem up here. They have encampments up here in Marinwood. Mm-hmm. What would they be willing to do to help solve part of that problem up here in their community? And also, just for somebody to flippantly say, well, we can move it down to the canal, down by the bridge, or down by Target, but that's toxic waste dump too. Mm-hmm. And that's liquefaction. When you have an earthquake there, that's probably worse than up here. People can tend to push things out of their communities, but my question to the communities is, what are you willing to do then?
I think this is really going to be an overall countywide community discussion. Again, I'll go back to the premise. We're not that unusual. I think homelessness now, if you look at even some of the priorities up in Sacramento now, homelessness is one of the top. I actually represent our county at the National Association of Counties, meaning once a year I'll go back on a legislative trip to Washington, D.C., pushing for issues of concern to our local communities. Homelessness was one of the top issues in the nation at the National Association of Counties. So I think where you're coming from is, we all need to be talking about this. We all need to be coming up with ideas. So not only is there going to be a process from our end, we're banking on that input and those ideas. Justin, I think you have another question.
The only thing I was going to say was when John had brought up, why not put it in Ross? Obviously, I don't think that's necessarily the answer either, because I think all of us as residents shouldn't wish for this issue to affect other communities that aren't necessarily our own. So that's where I really appreciate both you, Damon, and the San Rafael City Council, and you, John, really putting an emphasis on looking at the impacts on existing communities and placing mm-hmm. that as top priority. So
yeah, it's got to make sense.
Yeah.
A couple of people have mentioned liquefaction and everything. I don't know if you guys know about a website called Temblor, TEMBLOR.net. This was co-founded by a earthquake specialist professor at Stanford. You put in your home address, and it will come up with a number between 0 and 100 telling you how safe your house is.
Do we want to know that?
Or any place. But it's really very interesting because it will measure liquefaction, chance of landslides, and closeness to fault lines. But it's Temblor, TEMBLOR.net. And then you do have to give them your email address, and then when there's an earthquake around, they'll just send you a little email that if you would like to know more about it, you can. But it's actually, I live on Cedar Hill, and I think I'm 45 or something out of 100, and down in Fremont, the number's like 95.
Yeah.
So liquefaction is one of the big things in there.
Okay, unless there's any other questions, thank you very much, everyone. This
thank
is a
you.
Great conversation. Again, apologies for, although it sounds like we didn't miss much with the game today.
No.
Oh, my God. Okay, so, thank you. Thank you, everyone. Let's keep in touch.